I think the idea of speaking directly to the people that we want to serve, I think that's a huge deal. It's about taking down the barriers. What is it that keeps people from coming in? And if the lack of knowing that there are services there is a barrier, well, let's get rid of that. And so we went to the city of Las Vegas and just said, we're trying to do a campaign that we're gonna really meet people street level, eye level, in bus stops that are covered, in some big posters. And we know that very often individuals who are homeless will go looking for something to eat by digging into trash cans. Imagine putting some advertising of some kind that just says very, very simply, if you're hungry, come to the Salvation Army. You don't need to dig in this trash can. Come and get a meal.
The only criteria to get services from Salvation Army is need. So if you're in need of shelter or a meal, all you need to do is walk through our doors.
This morning we're going out to the community, invite them to come and join us for a free meal. Or if they need a place to stay, also invite them to the shelter.
Come and join us for a meal today, and we'll talk about shelter for you too.
Okay, sounds good.
Great, we'll make sure you have a bus pass to get to work tomorrow.
Okay.
We do have a lot of available beds right now. We've opened up another building for this month.
Homelessness, it's very fluid. So a lot of folks that come to Las Vegas, they don't know that we have this community meal.
It's a very desperate area where people are out there seeking assistance, or maybe they just don't have a place to go and they just sleep out on the street.
Pues vaya allí a ver cómo le podemos ayudar, okay? Como a la una y media.
Okay.
Bueno.
We have beds in the shelter. You don't need to sleep on the street tonight.
Thank you.
Good to meet you, buddy.
Good to see you again, Jerry.
All right. Take care.
We serve community meals every day, 365 days a year at 1:30.
To say to somebody, hey, we're just looking for you. We just want to tell you that we have a place that you can sleep. If we just wait for people to walk through the door, for some people, they'll never walk through the door. Our teams have made a priority to go and find people, to know who they are, then somebody will come through the door.
Our goal is to create a system where homelessness is rare and brief. We know we're in a place where we're needed. We found our calling in life.
You get a little bit of stability, you get some confidence, you get back into the rhythm of life. And seeing those dots get connected and seeing people end up in housing and kids who are not hungry and parents who get their kids back. I mean, there's nothing better than that. And we want to be part of that. It's a simple ad campaign, but it sets up a future and it sets up happiness and it sets up hope.
Now that's what we're talking about. Good stuff. Welcome back to this session on best practices from across America. It's going to be a fascinating time to learn and to listen, and I know that it's going to be extremely beneficial to all of us. Are you expecting change? All right. Follow-up question. Are you experiencing change? Change starts inside of us, doesn't it? Got to see it, got to believe it, got to feel it, and we have to have the faith that it's going to occur. The gospel is all about change. The gospel is the change story. Socially, spiritually, personally, the gospel transforms, and that's the great message that we have here. Now, those of you who have been with the Salvation Army for any length of time at all, you realize that we love acronyms. We have initials to describe anybody and everybody and anything within our movement. And if you're around long enough, you will become an acronym. It'll be on your card, and you can wear that proudly. Well, the National Advisory Organizations Conference is commonly referred to as NAOC, as we know. But I've come up with a new acronym. Let me run it by you. N, now is the time. A, advancement is our goal. O, others remain our purpose. And C, Christ is still the hope of the world. God bless you. Enjoy this conference.
One of the highlights of NAOC has always been the opportunity to meet others from around the country and exchange ideas. This morning, we present members of the Salvation Army's National Advisory Board, who will briefly highlight some of the many ideas submitted by Corps and volunteers throughout America for inclusion in this best practices book. Please hold your applause as we welcome Sally Harris, Chairman of the Service Extension Unit in Great Barrington, Massachusetts. Sally has served 18 years on the National Advisory Board and was involved on the Manhattan Advisory Board for 10 years. She's a third-generation volunteer. Both her parents chaired the Dallas Advisory Board, and her mother, Ruth Altschuler, legendary in her work with the Salvation Army, raised funds for the Carr P. Collins Social Service Center in Dallas, named in honor of her father. Mike Kassling is president CEO of a healthcare organization in Omaha. He currently is serving his first 3-year term on the National Advisory Board and has been actively involved on the Omaha Advisory Board for more than 25 years. Mary Thoreau is a senior vice president of the Independent Institute in Oakland and also follows in her mother's steps of service with the Salvation Army. Mary is a co-chair of this NAOC and has been involved at the national board level for more than a dozen years and has been actively involved for 20 years on the San Francisco and Alameda County Advisory Boards. Bill Burke, Senior Vice President for Nationwide Insurance and Chairman of the Army's National Advisory Board, has served on the NAB for 5 years. He's been an active member of the Army's Advisory Board in Columbus, Ohio for more than 20 years. Marlene Klotz-Collins was involved in the newspaper and television community in Phoenix for 4 decades. She currently is serving her 18th year on the National Advisory Board and has been actively involved on the Phoenix Advisory Board for 33 years. This is the second time she has co-chaired a National Advisory Organizations conference.
Thank you so much. We are so excited to have everyone here. And boy, could you believe that first session? It was just so inspiring.
It was amazing.
We get to experience that in such a big way.
And we've all been checking each other's mascara.
We have, actually. And you know what? We're so honored. The five of us are so honored to be representing the National Advisory Board this morning. And we've already met and seen Charlotte and Jerry and Jean, and they've served on our board as well. And Bill, of course, is our chairman this year. A couple others in the audience, and there are so many, but Mike Ducker is here with us. Mike is the president and CEO of FedEx Freight. Tony Thompson, the CEO of Krispy Kreme Donuts, is with us. And we love your donuts, Tony. We love your donuts. Thank you so much. Anyway, you've heard a little bit this morning already about the National Advisory Board. We want to just tell you a little bit more about that. We meet 3 times a year, and we rotate the territories to give everyone an equal opportunity to do that. And we have 4 committees within our organization, very similar to what you would see on a local level. They include advisory board development, community relations, business administration, and financial and institutional development. And then some of us serve on task forces as well. So the NAB makes recommendations to the Salvation Army. And these recommendations are then discussed right after our meetings with the Commissioners Conference. And that's the policymaking board of the Salvation Army in America. And it's comprised of our national leaders, Commissioners David and Barbara Jeffrey, our territorial commissioners, and you've been meeting them throughout the morning, and then the territorial leadership. So they meet, and of course they're with us during the meetings, but then they meet afterwards, and then they act on the recommendations that we make. We are invited to serve 3 3-year terms. We have to rotate off. Some come back for a second 9-year term, and then some become emeritus and go on. It was the National Advisory Board that recommended to the Salvation Army nearly 40 years ago that we start having conferences like this. And the first conference was held in 1983 in St. Louis, and they've been held every 4 years since that time. And these best practices have really become a tradition, beginning with Pasadena in 1999.
You know, I was at that. Goodness, what a difference in the volume. I was at NAOC in Pasadena in 1999, Marlene, and I just want to say, if there's a local advisory board up at the back who's feeling kind of alone and bewildered by what this all means. That was me 17 years ago. I was a new local advisory board member. I'd been on the board for 2 years. I'd just been made chairman in San Francisco, essentially because nobody else would do it. This is a true story. We were facing so many challenges in San Francisco, and everybody told it was hopeless. Just close down, forget about San Francisco. So I came to NAOC, and I sat way up, Pasadena, they were way up in the back seats, and I looked down on the stage, and I saw Marlene and Sally going through this best practices session, and I kind of started to feel hopeful. And then it grew. I went to workshops, took the best practices back. We copied them, and we're very successful there today. So these best practices truly are priceless, and I hope they are for everyone here today, too.
And Sally, you co-chaired that with Jonathan Kilmer, who's here with us today.
I did, and it was Jonathan's great idea to focus on best practices, because this organization has so many things that work, and yet the right hand may not know what the left hand is doing. So this is a wonderful focus for us. But the smartest thing we did is that we took best practices and we gave it to Marlene and put her in charge of it. And I call Marlene the queen of best practices, because she has just been gathering these wonderful, wonderful things in all these many years. And she did our very first book on best practices. And it was just tremendous. But what's astounding to me is that if you look at all of these extraordinary creative ideas that are sent in by officers, volunteers, staff, all of you, you send in your wonderful ideas about how you work through the Salvation Army to be Christ's hands in the world. And it is just... It's just so inspiring to me. So from Pasadena to Phoenix, we've gathered all these wonderful best practices, and they're essentially what works. So I want all of you to really tweak, listen, and tweak, and use these ideas so that they fit your community, because they're geared for large communities and for small communities.
Absolutely. And you know what? This is the 10th NAOC, and Phoenix is so proud to be hosting it. In almost 40 years. So I had to say that because I didn't mention it before, and that's really important, I think. Anyway, so what we're going to do, for the last better part of the past year, we have been soliciting those ideas, as Sally mentioned, and we're just going to touch on a couple of ideas from each of the categories that we received, and then at the end, you're going to receive your book. And you'll also, after the conference, these ideas are going to be placed on the app, so you can check them out in that regard. And Bill?
Well, we really do hope you use these ideas at the core level, spread them throughout your division and area command, and look for the nuggets that you can take. So pick up a book on your way out. There are some great, great ideas contained in the book.
NAOC really is all about strengthening our advisory organization, so we're going to start with that category right now. And Sally, want to take it?
Yes. Well, one of the most important things a new advisory board needs to know is what you expect of them. So there's a great best practice. I end up calling them great practices, great best practice. There's a practice from Anchorage, Alaska, and it's called the Advisory Board Job Description Signing. And each year, each advisory board member signs onto their job description. And it gives them a focus, it gives the Army a focus of how they can really use their energies and keep on mission to do that, whatever is expected of them to do. And it's resulted in 100% board participation, which I think is fantastic.
That's true. You know, advisors who commit to working together and doing professional development together are so much more effective. And there's a great program going on in Phoenix and Denver, the Divisional Advisory Organizations Conference. So it's modeled after this gathering, but it's at the division level. In the years that there isn't an NAOC, they bring everybody together for a one-day conference. They have guest speakers for keynotes. They break out into workshops, much as we'll be doing, and they'll go visit programs and so on. I had a pleasure of speaking at the one in Denver last year, and I can really attest that the strength of their advisory organizations reflects that commitment to working together to learn and to grow.
Mary, that's great what they're doing in Phoenix and Denver, and it's great that you had an opportunity to speak there. And I think the National Advisory Board are actually an overlooked resource. And I know all the NAB members, and including myself, would be more than happy to speak at a divisional seminar and meetings. So you really have a built-in speaker bureau. And we know from the attendance in the sessions that you'll see today and tomorrow around advisory organizations, the number of people that are very interested in the growth and vitality of those, creating those on the divisional level would be a great idea moving forward.
Yeah, and you know, Mike, to no surprise, the most popular workshops that have been signed up for really relate to creating a better advisory board. Now, two of them are being presented twice to provide all those who are interested the opportunity of being able to attend. So the titles of them are Building and Sustaining an Effective Advisory Board, and that's available during both of this afternoon sessions. And then Six Tips to Running Better Board Meetings is being offered today at 3:30 and also again tomorrow morning.
And Minneapolis has created a 50-page toolkit. So you don't need to go out and reinvent the wheel in doing this, but look to what Minneapolis has done. And it has lots of recommendations from strategic planning to how to present your members. But my favorite one is the one about the Salvation Army language, the acronyms, because when you get involved and you don't know what a DHQ, NHQ, TC, CRD, NAB, ARC, and she even said, Sally, you're the chairman of this SEU. And I went, what?
And you are.
I know, and I am,
about
and now I know it's an SEU.
We're going to talk about the ARC.
I love the NAOC. Now I think of that differently. It's wonderful.
Absolutely. Well, the Salvation Army is unparalleled in the work that we do with those within substance abuse recovery, and our ARCs are just a perfect example of that.
That's right, Marlene, and the ARCs have some important distinctions and programmatic differences. And to get a really great overview of what ARCs are and what those differences are and how they're so valuable, there's a good workshop at 1:45 today that provides a strong grounding in all things ARC.
And you know, it's interesting, we never think about this, but the ARC clients can very often be a great resource for spreading the word on the Salvation Army. So the ARC in Denver has developed a great partnership with Bass Pro Shops. Bass Pro invites the Army to bring trucks to their stores for collection during National Salvation Army Week, and ARC clients share their stories and testimonies with donors. Bass gives 25% off coupons for everyone who donates, too, as
That's
part of
great.
That promotion.
And thanks to two of our newer board members, there's exciting opportunity to vastly increase the contributions for the ARC. Joanne and Joseph Calloway from Arizona here are bringing the entire real estate industry to the Salvation Army. And things are really starting to explode around the country. Marlene, you want to tell us a little bit more about that?
Yeah, you know what? The Callaways are amazing. They're highly successful here in Arizona, but they are respected all over the country. And they have authored two best-selling books, and they've included The Salvation Army in their second one. They would have put it in the first one, but it hadn't been published yet. Or they found out about the Army afterwards, I should say. But they're crazy in love with the Salvation Army. Jim Nordstrom, one of our board members, mentioned to me yesterday after hearing their report, said, they are so inspiring. You know, they are the real deal, and they're salt of the earth. They're here today in force with a lot of people. They registered 15 delegates because they wanted their staff and fellow realtors to know about it. But their most current program is called Real Estate for Rehabilitation, and its primary purpose is working through title companies and real estate agents. Everyone who buys or sells a home has to go into that little room and sign the paper. Well, now there are these little trucks that look like an ARC truck that are going to be in a whole lot of title companies. A lot of the ARC administrators already have them. They are filled with business cards with the phone number of who to call when you are buying or selling a home and need to clean out, to call the Salvation Army. We did this program last year in Phoenix. In the first year, we had a 5,000 ticket increase. That's 5,000 more calls than we had the year before. And there was like a $100,000 difference in the first quarter this year in our bottom line, and we attribute it in large part to Real Estate for Rehab. They're doing this workshop Saturday morning, and if you have an ARC in your community, this is really something that you want to know about. They're traveling the country right now to talk about.
Well, I think it's very exciting to think of targeting an industry like the real estate industry and linking it with housing and linking it with homelessness and the ARCs and gathering all the goods. in Minneapolis 6 years ago, they did something related to realtors called Realtor Ring Day. And they selected one day, and on that day, realtors manned the kettles in the states of Minnesota and North Dakota. And it was extremely successful. And this, it's now spread to 30 states. And this year, I think it's December the 2nd, real estate salesmen will be out there ringing the bell. And I kept saying, who better to tell the story than this, about the Salvation Army than a real estate broker?
Absolutely.
I mean, they have so much energy, and I mean, it's tremendous.
They do, and the doors have been opened in very, very high places because of what Joanne and Joseph have done. Kelsey Madison from the Central Territory Northern Division started the Realtor Ring Day, and we've talked about how the program that the Callaway started 3 years ago, Real Estate Wednesdays, and there's a workshop on that this afternoon, is actually engaging the realtors on every Wednesday between Thanksgiving and Christmas. And we have seen an amazing bottom line with that. So what's happened is the doors that are being opened now on a national basis, Kelsey will start to see some changes in his Realtor Ring Day because of what the doors that are being opened even bigger for them.
That's so true, Marlene. This NAOC is all about cross-fertilization, our exchanging ideas. But we don't have to wait every 4 years to come together as NAOC. You can do it on a local basis annually in the Del Oro Division, which includes many smaller communities in Central California, as well as Nevada, as well as larger urban issues. The Development Department does a holiday best practices book. So they gather together lots of ideas for holiday fundraisers you can have. They have sample press releases, sample appeals for grants to support them, ideas for social media and online fundraising tips. They're happy to share it. The email address is in your best practices book. Email them, they'll shoot it back electronically, and you'll be easily able to adapt it to your own division.
And a lot of us are familiar with Angel Tree and how great it is to put a smile on a kid's face at Christmas. But a lot of times we don't think about how difficult Christmas is for those seniors without families. The Corps in Pennsylvania has a great solution. So once all the tags are taken for the kids, they have additional tags for seniors with ideas and information on how you can help seniors. If you want to learn more about Angel Trees, again, there's a workshop in session one. And I do want to point out, we're talking a lot today about workshops. If you have not signed up yet, please look at your book, listen to what we're talking about today, and just show up at those workshops today and tomorrow.
They're great. You know, another fun Christmas idea, and this involves just individuals, but Bill and Kay Shover, and I think they're here with us this morning, love the Salvation Army. 5 years ago, they started ringing one Saturday each Christmas season and started sending out notes in their Christmas cards just saying, meet us at the kettle. And if you can't meet us, you know, we're happy to take your donation in advance. So they start their day with some money in the kettle. Last year, in one day, they raised over $11,500. That's the power of two people, you know. So just look around and see who's there. Another gentleman in Arlington, Texas, does a really cool thing. He loves the red kettles. So he chooses two kettles on the days that he wants, and he finds the volunteers and staggers them to start at the top of the hour and the bottom of the hour, and then he runs and takes a picture when they start to ring, and then while they're ringing, he runs and develops it at Walgreens and so takes great. It back to them. It's easy, and then he gives it to them as a thank you as they walk away, and then he puts it on Facebook, and they have seen a change. All these little things.
And another high-energy person doing most good.
Yes.
Fabulous.
Yes, yes, yes.
Yeah, so in a group this size, statistics say there are at least six people who are tweeting right now. Is there anybody tweeting out here right now? So and it is evolving like crazy. So we're bringing the whole Christmas promotional issue into the 21st century using Twitter. And there's a great example of that on a program called Hashtag Redout. And that thing is called a hashtag in front of the word, in case anybody doesn't know that. Not a pound sign, it's a hashtag. And it's a great, fun social media interactive program in the Twin Cities. It's a day-long campaign on a Friday in December, and people are encouraged to wear red, snap a photo of themselves, and post it on Instagram or Twitter, and using the hashtag redout sign. So please be sure to check out the details on this. It's a very cool, colorful, and 21st century program.
That's great. The NAB met last January in Jackson, Mississippi, and found out how dynamic a community it is. They have a really great program that would be easy to copy anywhere. It's called Ring It to Bring It. And you could use it with any group, in any community. You can have local celebrities, you could have a group of cheerleaders, you could have service clubs and so on. You just give each member of the group a bucket with a shield on it and a bell, and you say, go out, get $500, and bring it in.
Another great idea comes to us from Lexington, Kentucky. It's the Kettle Club Pin. It's a great fundraiser idea, but also a great way to visibly show and promote the Salvation Army. What they do is they sell a Kettle Club Pin. They sell it for $100. The first year they sold 443, and that continues to grow. And this year they're hoping to get local retailers involved. So if you show up with a pin on your chest, you get a discount at that store.
And another approach to the kettle comes from Charlotte, North Carolina. It's called I Am. And what it is it's a program to embrace and include clients who are helped at Christmas time. So if someone comes to get an Angel Tree card to help their family, they are asked by the Corps, would you like to ring the bell for 4 hours and join our Christmas effort, which I think is extremely thoughtful, as the Salvation Army is.
Absolutely. We had a lot of submissions from the Western Pennsylvania Division. And Bill?
Yeah, you know,
yay.
Western PA, woo! There was a great thing that Charlotte said when she was talking before about the strength of the Salvation Army brand, one of the most trusted brands in the world, and a brand that other organizations like to affiliate with. And the Dallas Cowboys may be our most visible example of that. But we have great examples with partnerships we have with Walmart and Target and other national retailers. Well, some really cool things going on in Pittsburgh. So as a reminder to take advantage of those great relationships we have. In Pittsburgh, they had a man in the sleeping box bag drive. The man in the box, thank you. I'm being coached by Western Pennsylvania. Thank you, folks, you're right on. So get this now, they collected more than 300 sleeping bags over one November weekend. That's one weekend, 300 sleeping bags at 6 Walmart stores, and raised enough money from that first weekend to buy another 100 sleeping bags. Wow. Amazing program.
And the other thing they did that was great with Man in the Box is they really took advantage of it as a PR opportunity. What they did is the CBS radio station had a personality live in a plexiglass box on the 3 coldest days in February and spend the night in an Army shelter. During that time, there were interviews that were done. It was a very powerful awareness. Besides raising money, it raised awareness. And the Pennsylvania Association of Broadcasting gave them a special award for this to the CBS radio station. And it was a great connection with this whole drive around homelessness.
That's a great reminder that free media exposure can pay huge dividends. So look for where you can get it. In San Francisco, we now have a highly successful program called Dig Deep San Francisco that resulted entirely from a 2002 newspaper article about the Salvation Army running out of toys over Christmas time, and it had a picture of empty shelves. Well, one man saw that article, and he went out and he spent $10,000 of his own money buying toys and gave them to the Salvation Army. Subsequently, he's brought in his partner. He's also in real estate. Realtors must have big hearts. And they now work their networks, go out to their friends and their clients and ask them to dig deep to provide the money. And then they've added on to it, it allows them to partner with retailers, we were talking about it again, so they can have exclusive shopping sprees to spend that money. So they've partnered with Target and sporting goods stores and everybody. And one year they even got Fabio involved. And so you can also then invite the media to come and get media exposure, and it can feed on itself. This past year, they raised $110,000 for new toys.
That's great, Marion. We've heard a lot of great examples about partnering with retailers, and you can do that with any size retailer in any size community and adopt that to your needs. And National Salvation Army Week is a great opportunity to find and partner with those retailers in your communities. Denver has a great one with Bass Pro Shops, which we talked about earlier. It's called Allure of the Rockies. It includes a morning and afternoon grill. Army volunteers bag the items for the people and get donations back. There's a silent auction all day, an evening concert. What a great celebration. What a great way to partner with that retailer and make great money for the Salvation Army.
Absolutely. And that program actually started with a cold call to Bass Pro Shops, Sandy Gable in Denver. Just went in and sat down and met with the gentleman in charge of philanthropy and told him about the Army and what the Army was doing in Denver, not unlike what we've heard this morning. And that's what happened. And now they're calling the Army saying, I have another idea. I mean, and this is, we're just telling you a couple of things they're doing with Bass Pro Shops. You know, I want to mention that there are contact names and emails with all of your best practices. And it would be such an honor for these individuals to hear from you around the country. As Sally said, no need to reinvent the wheel. You know, the wheel's been created in so many of these. Just pick it up and copy it. Put your logo on it. Tweak it to make it work for your thing. We have a couple of minutes. Mary, why don't you talk about Fellowship Day in San Francisco?
Well, in San Francisco, we've partnered with the Giants. And it's actually the Giants Players of Faith who are behind it. So one game a year they designate as Fellowship Day. We have an officer sing the national anthem. A giant check is presented on field. Throughout the game, there are promos for the Army on the Jumbotron and so on. And then at the end of the game, people who want to stay are invited to come down to a smaller section. A stage is set up on the field, and players from both teams, the Giants and the team they're playing that day, are on stage sharing their testimony, and it's just extraordinarily powerful. And even if you don't have a pro team in your community, if you have a minor league team, if you have a popular school team, it's a wonderful way for the community to come together and share their faith.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. We're going to take just a break. We've seen a couple of the Evangeline Booth Award presentations this morning. What an inspiration. If you aren't aware, Evangeline Booth was national commander. She was the daughter of William and one of the daughters of William and Catherine Booth. And she was national commander in America for 30 years. Can you imagine? Yeah. From 1903, I think, to 1934. Can you imagine? And she was a remarkable woman. So just great. Anyway, we're going to have another Evangeline Booth Award presentation.
It was about 12 years ago that a group of dedicated women in Houston that were involved with the Salvation Army to some extent or another decided, let's activate a women's auxiliary.
There were 49, I believe, charter members of our group. We now have almost 500 in our organization. It's, for one thing, it's a sisterhood of wonderful, wonderful women. And these were women that came together for many different reasons, but one of the reasons was the appreciation of what the Salvation Army has done in Houston.
It speaks to my heart. It has since day one. We are privileged to work with some incredible people and hands-on with the people that are in need through the family residence, through Sally's house, through the program we do at Christmas, the Boys and Girls Clubs. We actually get to meet the people that we serve, and that is such a privilege. We have been ambassadors for the Salvation Army throughout the city. People come up to us all the time. We didn't know y'all did that. We thought you only rang bells. But we all know that the Salvation Army works 365 days a year, and we have done our best to make that message possible.
We decided that we would have a fundraising, one fundraiser a year. We named it Reflections on Style, so that it would have a continuing name that would become known in Houston.
When we started this, we really didn't have any idea how people would feel about, we felt like they'd be good about donating the clothes, but we didn't know how they would feel about buying used clothes.
And that first year, and every year since, we raised enough money to benefit every facility that the Army serves in Houston.
We went to the core locations and we said, you know, how can we help? And each of the locations would put together a list of things that they needed and that just wasn't in their budget to be able to do.
In their short history, they've been able to raise over approximately $3 million that have impacted youth, that have impacted seniors, that have impacted the clients that we serve throughout the Air Command.
They are more than happy to give away 90% of what they earn. They keep very little for themselves. I think there are some beautiful Christian women that make up this organization.
I look at the Women's Auxiliary here, and I think of two words, grace and power. Truly, I think there was someone in our organization that said, our best men are women. And I think that guy was on to something. But grace and power, just wonderful ladies that have impacted our lives personally, but have impacted this appointment for years to come.
Introducing the founder and CEO of the world's largest independent advertising agency, a proud member of the Art Directors Hall of Fame, recipient of the Pratt Distinguished Alumnus Award, the University of Texas at Austin Reddick Award, and the AIGA Gold Medal. He's the namesake of the nationally recognized University of Texas Stan Richards School of Advertising and Public Relations and head creative director at the Richards Group, Mr. Stan Richards. Stan's passion for great advertising and design is rivaled only by his genuine love for humanity. Along with his commitment to dozens of nonprofits benefiting local, national, and international causes, Stan has been involved with the Salvation Army for almost 40 years. As a lifetime member of the Dallas-Fort Worth Advisory Board, Stan's best-known contribution to the Salvation Army may be his agency's national brand work. What began as a simple pro bono assignment 11 years ago grew organically to become the first national brand strategy in the history of the Salvation Army. Since 2005, Stan and the Richards Group have been proliferating the power and reach of the Salvation Army through award-winning advertising campaigns, lucrative strategic partnerships, and memorable one-on-one connections. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the man who helps us do the most good every single day, Mr. Stan Richards.
Thank you very much for the warm reception. I appreciate that. 39 years ago, a friend asked if I would be interested in serving on a local advisory board for a drug and alcohol rehab center in Dallas. I didn't know it then, but walking through the doors of the Salvation Army ARC for that first meeting, it would change me. I'll never forget what I saw there. Each month, I would walk through the intake area and see large groups of men waiting to get a bed. Men in the most desperate states of hopelessness and addiction. If you ever want to know what rock bottom looks like, just visit the intake area of an ARC. But what amazed me was the sharp contrast between those men and the men I would see inside. These were men who were already in the program, and you could see a clear difference because over time, their countenance would change. Their physical bearing would begin to rally. Their eyes would have that spark of life rekindled. You can actually see hope building in them. You can see dignity restored through acts of kindness. It's an amazing thing to witness and an even more amazing thing to be a part of. How remarkable is this organization to operate the largest residential drug and alcohol rehabilitation program in the country over 100 locations nationwide with exactly $0 in cash contributions. What an inspired model to accept discarded items from donors in order to reclaim discarded lives, to recycle those items in order to rebuild families ruined by addiction. Over the years, I've met hundreds of young men in the ARCs. And in that time, I've seen how devastating the drug culture has become for our youth and minorities. Every year, more than 200,000 men and women and their families depend on the ARCs for help. And the officers, soldiers, and staff are always there to provide it. But after 10 years on the ARC Advisory Council, I was honored to be added to one of the most dynamic advisory boards in the country, the Dallas-Fort Worth Area Command. And being a small part of the Army's work with Dallas's other vulnerable populations has been both humbling and inspiring. Because every day, the Salvation Army is changing lives, giving homeless families a respite from the dangerous heat of a Dallas summer, helping women and children escape domestic violence and rebuild their lives, providing kids in underserved neighborhoods with the opportunity to participate in athletics and arts programs when the local schools can no longer afford to fund them, relieving tens of thousands of hardworking moms and dads who no longer have to choose between buying their kids a Christmas present or putting food on the table. The list goes on, and the Army is there providing for every one of them. One of my favorite moments of working with the Army has been watching my associates at the Richards Group getting involved too. Every year, teams of two or three people will reserve hour-long red kettle shifts, volunteering to ring the bell at a nearby mall. There are always hundreds of volunteers, so for several days, people randomly disappear from their desks. And I'm okay with that. The bell ringing has become one of my favorite Christmas activities because when I ring the bell, I get to watch how the Army is shaping the concept of philanthropy in each new generation. It never fails that you'll see this if you ever ring the bell. Mothers and fathers giving their toddlers a dollar to drop in the kettle. That's the children's first experience with philanthropy, and it's often a lasting lesson. And finally, I'm thankful to say that for the past 11 years, the Army has embraced not just me, but the entire Richards Group. It's been our honor to help develop and foster the first national brand strategy in the history of the Salvation Army in America. I speak for 719 of the brightest, most talented people in advertising when I say thank you for giving us the great privilege to be stewards of your brand. So many officers, staff members, and fellow board members have impacted my life over the last few decades, and I'd like to especially thank a few of them. First, Bill and Deborah Mockabee. Without your leadership, there is no doing the most good. There is no national brand strategy, and thank you for trusting us to help you during your time in Dallas. George and Donna Hood, your vision for expanding our work to the national stage made possible our close national relationship with the Army. Ron and Carol Busrow, thank you for your leadership today and your vision for making the Salvation Army a thought leader among charities. It's been a privilege to serve you in this effort. Bobby Lyle, my friend, who is also being honored here, your heart for the Salvation Army is inspiring, and your strategic leadership in Dallas, nationally and even internationally, will serve the Army for generations to come. Thank you for your friendship and your example. Charlotte Anderson, you helped the Army accelerate. As I watch the progress that has been made in Dallas over the years, I think about the work that we've had the opportunity to do nationally over the past decade. I know that much of that success was possible only because of your leadership on the National Advisory Board. And lastly, I would like to thank the heart and soul of the Salvation Army, the officers. I have been incredibly fortunate to have witnessed firsthand the tireless work of these passionate and capable men and women. the intense love that they have for the least among us, and the values they have passed on to their children, often six or seven or even eight generations deep. To be honored today is humbling. I will always treasure this moment, but more importantly, I will treasure every moment I get to play some small part in this mission to serve humanity, to do the most good. Thank you.
Stan, you are such an inspiration to all of us, truly. And
indeed, thank you.
The spirit of your organization just totally represents the embodiment of this room, of the mission, and Evangeline Booth. So thank you again and again. Well, you know, the Army is, as we know, all about serving people. And when we think about disaster, when I think about disaster, I often think about the national disasters and 9/11 and Sandy and New York and things like that. But to the people who have the disasters in their everyday lives, when their homes burn down or there's a homicide or a horrible traffic accident, that's their major national disaster, personal disaster. In Milwaukee, the police department realized that they didn't have anyone when they were out responding to these kinds of calls. They didn't have anyone by their side to help minister, that's not their term, but I would say minister to the emotional needs of people who are being struck by these tragedies. And you know, they went to the Salvation Army in Milwaukee and said, can you help us? What can we do to assure that we have someone there to help people when these incidents happen? And the Army in Milwaukee in that city put together a chaplaincy program, which is going to be in your book and app, of course, but they amassed a group of 50 clergies from around the seven districts that are served by the Milwaukee Police Department. So now when the officers are out on the scene of something horrific that they really don't have time, and they felt bad they couldn't, but anyway, they have a list of 50 different people, chaplains that they can call to come and assist. And you know, I read that best practice and thought, that's something that we can do in any size community we have. You know, call our police department and say, is there something we can do? And call Milwaukee first and find out how they put it together, and a great best practice. So we're gonna move on now and talk about our next generation, and that would be Echelon. And building stronger communities, we need to look toward the future, which we are in a very big way, and no one has led that any harder than Sally Harris on our national board.
Oh, it is my passion. And just as officers are so often multi-generational, I'm a multi-generational Salvation Army volunteer. The Social Service Center in Dallas is named for my grandfather, Carpy Collins. And he would have been on an advisory board if there'd been one at the time, but there wasn't. But my mother and father both chaired the Dallas advisory board, so they've passed that on to me. And my niece was one of the co-founders of this brilliant thing I'm going to tell you about called Echelon, if you don't know about it. But one of the concerns that I had when I joined the board in New York City is I was 35 years old, and I looked around me, and everyone on the board was old. I mean, old. And, you know, and now I'm old, and I'm like, you know, but it's really important to bring the next generation along. And at first I wanted to go off the board, and I said, no, I have to stay on the board to bring their average age down, you know. But what happened was the Richards Group actually supervised a nationwide set of focus groups to see what millennials know about the Salvation Army. And it was very interesting. They knew about the Salvation Army, they were aware of the Salvation Army, but what do you think of when you think of the Salvation Army? Old clothes, old furniture, old bell ringers, you know, old. So we really said, okay, enough. What are we going to do about this? And in Dallas, I think a wonderful model came up. There were different models addressing this for different ages. But this wonderful word, echelon, has been applied to a wonderful model, which was, it started as a junior women's auxiliary. It was kind of thought of as a junior women's auxiliary, and these two young, just out of college with their texts, got all their friends together, and they did all these wonderful projects in coordination with the Salvation Army. But over time, my niece actually said, let's get some guys. And the minute it went co-ed, the thing went through the roof. Because everybody wanted to network. They just graduated from college. Maybe they went away to school. They wanted an opportunity to meet other people. So it was a really sort of a fertile idea. They started to get together. They came up with ideas. The marketers, the retailers, all wanted to give sponsorships because they want to speak to that age. So it was a perfect, wonderful storm of need. And it was not just fundraising. It was creative ideas of helping people at the ARCs write resumes to get jobs. I mean, it's just phenomenal. And I am so proud of everyone who's been working on this echelon. We now have 10 chapters from Anchorage to Milwaukee to Peoria to Dallas to Phoenix. And there are literally dozens more in different stages of evolving. But it's a model that works. And if you must know what Echelon is before you leave. Absolutely. Great network.
Mike?
And Sally, that's great. And like you, I got involved in the Salvation Army at an early age. I was in my 20s. Some friends of the family introduced me and asked me to be on the board. And the Echelon is such a critical thing for the Salvation Army. It's so important that we involve, we make the next generation aware, get them involved, so they're part of the Army for years to come, as I have been. Echelon, right here in Phoenix, is gearing up for their second annual Do Good Derby. So it's mirrored after the Kentucky Derby, including the Seersuckers and Spring Hats. They're raising money, but also driving awareness. From our friends in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, they have Get Your Phone Out and Give, a Christmas campaign, again, to raise awareness as well as funds.
Yeah.
A great idea comes from the Echelon Chapter in St. Louis, where they have the Garbage Bag Gala. It's a great fashion show featuring styles created with recycled materials. Get that, recycled materials. That's what a great idea. And as Sally, as you said, Echelon is all about a creativity and excitement in spreading the great news of what the Army does to the next generation.
Absolutely, and that's our segue into even more of the fundraising ideas done by the Corps all over the country.
That's right. You don't have to be a large community to do a successful fundraiser. Waltham, Massachusetts has a population of just 63,000. At its core, raised $68,000 last year in its 120th anniversary with a red tie gala. And the entire cost of $30,000 were covered by in-kind donations.
Another great idea from a smaller Corps comes to us from Youngstown, Ohio. And it's really important that advisory board members around the country get involved and help with the fundraising. What they've done there is each of the board members goes out to local organizations, individuals, foundations, and so forth, and asks them for $1,000. So through that campaign, they raised $60,000 annually. And there's a lot more ideas in the Best Practices book that you should look to emulate or adopt to your local communities.
Absolutely. And we're going to move now on to the Croc Centers. We have them all over the country.
Yay, Crocs.
So a lot of the ideas which we'll hear about, and what I'm going to talk about from Biloxi, Mississippi around the Croc Centers, you don't have to have a Croc Center to adopt these ideas. You can take these ideas and adopt them for your local community. Mm-hmm. But in Biloxi, Mississippi, they have a great idea. So they're going after a niche, but very large and fast-growing market, which is homeschooled kids. And what they're doing is they're bringing those kids, they have 80 to 100 involved, and they're bringing them in every week and having them involved doing physical education, Spanish, music, arts, swim classes. And what a great idea to help those moms and also help the Croc Center and get new members.
Now, you guys can't answer this question, but here's an open question for you. It's an easy quiz. So what nonprofit in America serves more children every year than any other? That's right, the Salvation Army. You are absolutely right. That is we are the number one provider of care and programs for children. And kids' programs always prove to be a great place to begin to connect volunteers into the Army. And in Greenville, South Carolina, the Croc Center has a program called SWAG. And SWAG is Saved with Amazing Grace. And during every day when they run the program, over 90 kids are served dinner. They take part in character-building classes, and then electives that include a wide variety of music and dance classes. And then all those classes are taught by volunteers.
It's a great way to get volunteers involved. Mm-hmm. Marlene, here in Phoenix, as you well know, the Croc Center has an adorable program that could also be replicated elsewhere called the Tot Prom. So it's for kids ages 3 to 6. They get all dressed up. They come with their date, which is their mom or their dad, and they have their prom pictures taken. They play games. They dance. They eat. And it's a really great way for kids to have a special bonding experience with their parents. They might not have other special things that they do together, so they create memories and that they can build on, and it really helps strengthen the families involved and gets them used to coming to the Army as well. Then in Hawaii, they have a comedy show that features family-friendly comedy, and it's another great way to bring families together to enjoy something at the center there.
One of the things we've been reading a lot about over the past several years, and it's a chronic problem, is childhood obesity. And in Grand Rapids, they have created a program to address this called Fit Kids 360. And the Salvation Army is really positioned to do something significant, and I'm sure they are in areas beyond Grand Rapids, but this is one program you might want to look at.
Yeah, and this isn't about fitness. This isn't about Croc, but it's all about fitness. In Minneapolis, they celebrated last year their 10th annual Most Amazing Race. Is that right? Yeah, the Most Amazing Race. They have raised so much money and, as importantly, so much awareness, and it's being duplicated. Oh, that's your thing. Tell us about it. I get so excited.
No, that's okay.
I promise you can talk about it.
No, you're right. It's patterned after the TV show. We've all heard about The Amazing Race. They've raised over $630,000 over that time, cultivated. They have more than 1,400 racers, 700-plus volunteers. What a great idea. And contact Julie Orlando if you have ideas around that. And if you think about it, for your local community, again, of any size, there's so many reality TV shows out now. I think every other show on TV is a reality TV show. But think about how you could take some of those great ideas and adopt them for your local community. In Mary's backyard in Oakland in San Francisco, they have a thing called Top Chefs. We're all familiar with Top Chefs. But what they do is they pit the fire department chefs against each other in a great outdoor event. The Salvation Army canteens are their where they work from. And what a great idea to bring awareness to the Salvation Army and what we do and involve the firefighters as well.
That's right. And as we know, certainly Echelon knows, social media provides us a lot of opportunities to get the word out using the power of networks. Last year, in conjunction with the International Salvation Army's 150th anniversary, San Diego had hashtag 150 stories. So the goal of that was to get 150 stories shared of people touched by the Salvation Army. But you know, you could do it with any clever word or phrase, and your community as well. It only took San Diego a month to organize. They vastly increased their social media presence, and they also increased, importantly, their online giving.
A great idea comes to us from our friends in Maplewood, Minnesota, where they have the Red Carpet Awards. And it's for their adult day center, and it's patterned after the Oscars. And what they do is all the people get decked out in their gowns and their top hats. They're escorted down the red carpet, where the paparazzi are there to take their pictures. And they get all kinds of great awards, like Best Smile, Most Caring. And it's such a great event. And they don't raise a dime, but that event is absolutely worth a million.
Mm-hmm. On a quite serious note, Mississippi has one of the highest rates of teen pregnancy, and the governor, the Honorable Phil Bryant, the governor of the state, who also serves on an advisory board, came to the Salvation Army and asked for help. How can we do something about this? And they created a program through the Salvation Army, which essentially had a component of peer-to-peer counseling with young people, which was quite successful, and out of that they created task forces. And as a result, they've reduced teen pregnancy 11%, and they're now going for 17%. So again, the Salvation Army is just got wonderfully positioned to do all these, do the most good.
You know, Sally, if you can, I just want to repeat what Sally said. So the Honorable Phil Bryant, who is the governor of Mississippi, is a member of the advisory board. The governor and his wife are incredibly active in the Salvation Army in the state of Mississippi as a couple and as a family. And we had a chance to have our National Advisory Board meeting there a year ago, January. And it was an extraordinary experience, a very humbling experience to know that in this crazy year of political nonsense, that we have a solid governor in the state of Mississippi. So we thank Governor Bryant for his service, too. You know, maybe the most exciting and significant programs that the Army is engaged on across the country is Pathway of Hope. And we're going to hear much more about Pathway of Hope in our general session tomorrow. But we have four workshops on the process, on the topic as well. And one of the things that we did want to call out while we were here is talk about one of those best practices associated with Pathway of Hope, and that's Ironman. And that's done in the Alabama-Louisiana-Mississippi Division. Now, the program targets young men between 16 and 30 who are the product of many, many broken families. In many cases, they're underprivileged, they're school dropouts, and they're often drug runners. Now, the Army brings them together to hear speakers and straight talk about their potential. We collaborate with other agencies, and the Jackson Area Command reports that lives are really being changed as a result.
So exciting. So they do such great things. Everyone's doing such great things. It's fun to talk about them. I want to talk for just a minute about Red Kettle Clubs. We've talked a lot about Echelon this morning. And, you know, we're looking at the middle school and the high school students as well. We have several Red Kettle Clubs that have been formed around the country. The first one was started right here in the Valley in 2011 at Corona del Sol High School. Sherry Wilkinson is with us today. She's a member of the Tempe Advisory Board, but she wasn't a member of the Advisory Board when she worked with her daughter to get that started. And the whole idea is to engage these young kids. And we talk about the focus groups that we did when we were looking for Echelon. I'm here to tell you, you know, going into these high school classes with kids who want to get involved in community service, they're not even altogether certain about the thrift stores and ringing bells. So, core officers, look at Red Kettle Club members as, you know, paving the way for Echelon and then into even the next level of service. And Phoenix or Tempe, these kids, not just ring bells, they've helped us sign up families at registrations. They do the bilingual, they help with that. They're at the trees, of course, they do donation drives. It's amazing what they're...
And the Red Kettle Club in Milwaukee is going gangbusters. We talked about that a little bit earlier with Echelon. They just started in 2014, so they're fairly new at this. But they're already preparing snacks for kids that are staying at the emergency lodge. They're writing special cards to families that come to the Christmas dinner. And they dress up as donut girls for the local parade to bring awareness to what the Salvation Army is doing. And for those interested in this area, there is a workshop Saturday morning. And as I mentioned earlier, if you haven't signed up for workshops yet, don't worry. Just look at the ones you want to go to. If you heard some great ideas that you want to bring to your local community here today, just go and show up at those workshops.
I think it's just thrilling. We're getting high school and middle school kids involved. Yeah. And the Red Kettle Clubs are a great way to do it. They raise a lot of money. They get very involved. They have so much energy. It's wonderful to have that with us. And just as it helps we adults to get together and exchange ideas and brainstorm, the kids can benefit from that too. So again, here in Phoenix, they hold an annual Red Kettle Club Leadership Seminar, and they bring the Red Kettle Club leaders around from around the division, and they can exchange ideas and bounce new ideas off of each other and so on. In addition to the workshops and what you'll read about in the best practices book about Red Kettle Clubs, they have a really good website that it has all information about how to start a club, information about different activities, contact information for learning more, and it's a very easy URL to remember. It's redkettleclub.org.
Thank you, Mary. It is very easy. You know, we talk about the Salvation Army serving every zip code in America, and we can do that because of our service extension units. And we have on stage our own service extension.
I have a brand new chairman of a brand new service extension unit. I started volunteering for the Salvation Army in Manhattan, And now I live, 5 years ago I moved to a town in western Massachusetts of 7,500. It's a charming little Norman Rockwell town. But yay, and it's very, our service extension unit is, I'm it. And the one thing that's interesting about it, it's all volunteer. And we can actually say all the money that comes through our kettle stays in our community because we have no overhead, I'm a volunteer. And most of the, and I just want to commend, now that I know what it's like to do this, I want to commend all the service extension unit people. Because we really represent the voice, the public relations part of the Salvation Army. We can really make our communities know what the Salvation Army is in a way that the larger communities have, you know, budgets for advertising, and they're more high visible. We're really the ones. And in so many cases, the volunteers are working out of their kitchen and trying to organize all of these activities. We can also drive, through the awareness, we can get kids to summer camps, we can get people in need to ARCs, because we can represent an awareness of the Salvation Army, which we can share. A woman, but I do want to speak to someone much more experienced than I am, who's done a lot more with this than I have, and it's Peggy Kill from Morris, Minnesota, and she's sent us through the years some wonderful ideas that she's come up with and her service extension unit. And the one that I read about, I was reading through a lot of hers, and all of a sudden I found myself reading through and I just started crying. It was like watching one of these amazing stories that we've watched. And it was about a backpack program where children that depend on school lunches to eat on the weekends, this service extension unit was concerned that they were going to go hungry on the weekend and have nothing. And I've heard about this program in other locations as well, but to actually read about this through a service extension unit and knowing that someone in some small community is arranging for children to have food on the weekend so they won't wake up on Sunday morning with nothing to eat. That's fabulous. So I really highly recommend all of you service extension representatives, including me, to go learn about this.
I expect us to see one in Great Barrington real soon. We're going to move into strategic planning, but before we do, I just want to mention we are having a workshop, one in the first workshop session today, on public policy. It's labeled Heroin and Homelessness. It's a springboard to public policy. This is a very exciting area right now for us because we wear the shield. We can talk about programs that work like this, and a lot of very exciting things are happening around the country that are great door openers, and it really underscores the fact that people are looking to the Army to solve some of these problems, because you know what? The other stuff doesn't seem to be working most of the time. So they're looking at us, and we've got some great ideas on how you can move that forward. Mike, you're going to talk to us about strategic planning.
I am. Strategic planning is such a critical thing, not only in the corporate world, we do it all the time with our companies, but also equally important in the non-for-profit world. And actually, Bill is leading us through our second strategic planning at the National Advisory Board level right now. So there's some great workshops coming up both this afternoon and tomorrow morning around strategic planning. And it's so critical. We know the age-old adage, if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. And that is so true. So please take advantage of that. In our Del Oro division, they have a think tank group strategy meeting with officers and staff 3 times a year and discuss and brainstorm plans for the future. What a great idea. The only thing I would add to them is you should probably include some advisory board members and maybe some of in your local community to really give you a well-rounded view of where you need to go into the future.
And advisory board members are involved in our women's auxiliaries too.
They are. Women are the secret weapon of the Salvation Army. We all know that. From the beginning. The Harrisburg, Pennsylvania Women's Auxiliary goes by the name of WIN, Women Involved. I think that's just great. So they had their 4th annual shoe strut with more than 450 attendees and netted almost $60,000.
And I want to talk about the fashion show that Dallas does. It's in its 25th year. I know you saw one of the, I think you saw, at first I thought this was the Dallas show, but I think this was a Houston fashion show. Dallas started one 25 years ago, and they began by having professional models model clothes from the thrift stores, the family stores. And it every year it got better and more interesting and more people showing up, and now you can't get a ticket. It's really quite a sold-out, very, very chic affair. They sell gently used designer clothes, and they've made like $750,000. It's astounding for a fashion show.
It's amazing.
Wow. So I'm getting a theme here, Sally. Everything in Texas is big, I guess.
Yes.
Right? But
by the way, my mother told me to tell you, you have to do one of these shows. So,
so events really don't have to be big or complicated as well. They can be as simple and as effective as what occurs in Ithaca, New York, where the Women's Auxiliary has an annual super supper and auction that's super inclusive. They charge us $12 for an all-you-can-eat buffet and tie in a silent auction that's really a small, effective fundraiser.
What a great idea. 60 years ago in Cincinnati, they started the Toy Shop Auxiliary, and it was local women got together and dressed dolls and gave them to underprivileged kids at Christmas. So that's morphed, and now they continue to do that program. They have an annual doll auction. They raise over $4,000, and that goes to gather toys for kids. They help 4,700 children to get them dolls, teddy bears, books, and anything they need for Christmas.
Wow. You know, we've heard about a lot of best practices today. There are a lot more you're going to read about in the book and the app. But remember, your territories do a great job, a really great job on a very regular basis with your territorial publications. And those are chock full of great best practices. Think about how you can spin those concepts. In the Southern Territory, Salvation Army today is an opportunity not only to learn more about what others are doing, but to tell others what you're doing. And we're going to show you a video clip right now to explain a little bit more about Salvation Army today.
The Salvation Army is helping people in need around the world. Salvation Army Today shares those stories twice a week.
Events happening in North America, rebuilding communities in South America.
Anti-trafficking efforts in Europe, opening new opportunities for those in need in Australia.
And emergency disaster relief in Asia. The Salvation Army is everywhere, and we're sharing those stories with an international community.
If you have stories to share, send them to us. It's as easy as pulling out your phone to snap a photo or record an interview. And don't forget to share each episode with others. Help spread the word and our mission.
Priest and his, I'm not on. No. That's wonderful. Chris Priest and his team in the South are doing a great job, and please use that. We're gonna wrap up, two quick announcements. First of all, thank you for being such a thoughtful listening audience to us today, because we're really excited about all of this. And the Salvation Army has created a new advisory board book, policy manual, that's available on mysaboard.org, and that's for our volunteers and for the staff and officers. It's in the Red Shield Toolkit. And as you leave today, you're going to get a copy of Hot Off the Press, the Best Practices book. Right outside, go outside the door near the glass doors, and one per delegate, please. But please take these home and open them up and call these people and find out how they're doing their things. Have a great time at NAOC, and thank you.
Great. Good morning.
Well, now, before you leave, you want to hear from me, and you want to thank our panelists, our best practices panelists today. Many of you have phones. On that phone is an app. We would like for you to go on that app and evaluate these conferences. Now, when I was flying out here the other day, I went online and just gave every session a 5-star, because I knew and in hopeful anticipation they were all going to be great. But if you'll just take a few moments and do that after every session, it's very helpful for us to know what we need to do the next time we plan one of these. Thank you for coming. We've had a busy morning. You're going to a networking luncheon now. Now, what does that mean? We've already had enough program this morning. Go in, find a seat. There are table cards around that give you an idea of where we want to sort of divide up people. Try to sit with someone you don't know. There's some questions there that we'd like for you to discuss. Visit our exhibitors downstairs. We'll look forward to seeing you in the workshops. God bless you.